blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory, every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you'll be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days.
Shall we make it more resounding?
With a great parliamentarian, being the youngest to be elected to Rajya Sabha in the year 1974, and serving 5 times as Member of Parliament, 4 times to Rajya Sabha, and at the 5th time to Lok Sabha, almost for 3 decades, a great debater in our young days with commendable leadership skills, translated into political dynamism, would be a great inspiration to the young minds here this evening. Madam, we have here our faculty members across our institutions. We have also members from CASC and the press and our dear students. I have 30 minutes to spend with you, followed by questions by our students and of course today's audience for another 20 minutes. Shall we start? Shall we start from your childhood days? And my question would be basically to connect you to your political journey, primarily related to your struggle as a woman leader. Could you describe your childhood as a girl child? Because I remember reading in your autobiography on page number 4, my mother was disappointed at the birth of another daughter. How did you face this patriarchal world? I'm sure Margaret Alva of the 40s and the Margaret Alva of 2000 had a huge stride traversed.
I was born in Mangalore, and my mother recalls how she wept when she was told that she had had a third daughter. Of course, there was an older son, but she was hoping there would be one more son. You know, we mothers in India tend to be always suffering from a sunstroke. But it was my grandfather, her mother, who came to see her in the hospital early morning and said, "Never cry over the birth of a child. She will be your pride, and she is born on my birthday, and so she will be a great lawyer like myself." I don't know about being a great lawyer, but I certainly was as talkative as any lawyer could be. I did my early schooling in Mangalore up to the 5th class, all in Kannada medium. And it was after that, that when my father was posted in Coimbatore, that I moved, because there were English medium schools there. So my early memories, my upbringing, was all in a large family in Mangalore. And I am glad that my roots have withheld many storms.
Thank you, madam. And I'm told that you have also very good in Tamil languages, that you, yes, 5 languages.
I speak 5 languages.
Okay,
right.
Okay, yeah.
What the joke in my house is that Margaret can speak in any language on any subject, even when she's asleep.
Okay, that makes me to ask you a question on your experiences as a young college student. What shaped you in your formative years? Your leadership traits, your debating skills as a student, later party worker, parliamentarian, representative of the state abroad.
That will require an hour to recount, but I'll be as brief as possible. For one thing, I used to love to imitate public speakers. When I used to come home from church, I believe I would come and try to imitate the sermon of the priest in church in whichever language it had been, and so on. But I must say, I never looked upon myself as a public speaker. I used to act in plays in the convent annual days. But in Mount Carmel College, we were all walking towards Fatima Hall, which is the main hall. I was just in the PUC. And we were walking merrily when suddenly I had the head of English department, clap. And we were four or five of us walking towards the hall. And she pointed to me and said, "You come here." So I didn't know what had gone wrong. I said, "Yes, ma'am." She says, "You come this side and you come up here." So then she said, it was the day, the evening was for picking the college debating team. And I looked at her and she says, yes, you talk so much around the place, you'll do very well as a debater, come and sit here. I said, "Ma'am, I've never spoken and I don't know anything about today's function. We were just coming to watch the fun." She said, "No, you come." And I was so scared of her that we were just marched to the stage to sit on round, and it was a hat night, as they call it. You pick a topic and you start speaking for 3 minutes. And my knees were actually trembling, and we all sat around, and there was the jury, the judges and the principal and everybody. I was so new to the college. So I got co-education when my turn came. And I don't know how, I suppose it was the Holy Spirit. I picked up the topic and I started speaking on why it was so important for boys and girls to learn together, to learn to respect each other, and to share their college days. Well, I just spoke. And when it was over, I couldn't believe I had actually talked on a stage. That was the end of it. And the judges met, and I was shocked when they announced the results, and I was one on the list for the college team. From there began my public speaking. The principal, Mother Antoinette, was thrilled. And well, I must say, without flattering myself, that I went on to win every single debate in the university with shields and cups for the college. That was how I was discovered. And when I was at the United Nations in 1977, at the General Assembly moving the resolution for the admission of Vietnam to the United Nations on behalf of my country, I first recalled to mind my English professor who had pushed me up the stage in college years ago. That is one. The second, you ask about the party. I was in the party, a very junior member in Bangalore under Devrajas. And Indira Gandhi was coming to the Glass House to inaugurate a huge conference of the backward classes, the minorities, and the scheduled castes and tribes. It was at the Glass House. And Devrajars, I don't know why, said, we want one or two English speakers because all these people talk in Kannada here, and Indira Gandhi would like to hear one or two English speeches. So they chose me to go up and speak. And I spoke for about 6 to 7 minutes maybe on the need for the party to concentrate on the sections which had been excluded, which had been neglected, and which really were the base for the Congress. That 7-minute speech made my future, because Indira Gandhi was so impressed that when she came down, she came and patted me, and the next selection for the Rajya Sabha seats, I was one of those she put on the list. She had, didn't know my full name, she had forgotten. All she wrote was Mrs. Alva Junior. Okay. Because she knew my parents-in-law.
Okay.
And that's how in the middle of the night I was woken up and told, you know, you are one of the nominees. I thought it was a practical joke. I said, I have not even applied for a seat. What are you talking about? But that's how I got to the Rajya Sabha, thanks to this one speech which Mrs. Gandhi heard.
Yeah.
And so, you know, life, I feel, is actually a story of accidents. You don't plan for everything, but things do happen. I went to the Rajya Sabha. I worked in the party for 10 years, never expecting to be a minister, never asked to be a minister. I was asleep, actually, at home on the 31st of December, 1984, when I had no pass to go to the Rashtrapati Bhavan for the swearing in. Rajiv Gandhi was being sworn in. I was president of the Mahila Congress by then, but nobody would give us passes, you know, women are always kept out. We had no passes. So I gave up, I went home, went to sleep. Then the phone kept ringing once, twice. Then I picked it up, I said yes, because I was very angry. And then I said, "Kon bol rahe?" And then there was the voice, "Don't you recognize me?" I said, "Kon hai?" He says, "Rajiv." I said, "Who?" He said, "Rajiv Gandhi." I said, "Yes, sir." He says, "Come on, get ready. What are you doing at home?" I said, "I'm asleep." He says, "Asleep? Get ready and come to Rashtrapati Bhavan immediately." He didn't say to be sworn in for what thing. And before I could ask, he had put down the phone, and it was an order. I had no car, no driver, nobody to take me. I was alone. The children had all come to Mangalore for Christmas. So I rang up my brother, who took me, and I went and sat on the last row somewhere where there was a place, when suddenly someone discovered me and said, "Yahan kya kar rahi ho? Tumhara jagah samne hai." Only then I knew I was going to be a minister. So that was again one of those accidental things that have happened.
I think that was recounting being a backbencher to a treasury. Yes, from the Rajya Sabha, then you went on to become the member of Lok Sabha, only one. What is your, you know, experience as from started from backbencher and went up to the treasury later?
Yeah, you know, in the house, I can tell you, I've been in the opposition. I've been on the government benches. I have been in the chair as the presiding officer in both the houses. I fought fiercely against the government during Morarji Desai's rule. I have been, I must say, a very vocal minister when I was in the government. And I went to the Lok Sabha for 5 years. It was a do or die battle. I won from North Canara. And you said yesterday, people ask, what has she done for her constituency?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I don't go publicizing or publishing newspapers very often. Ignore us, that's okay, because we are very backward area in North Canara. But I took 10,000 crores in 5 years to my district, to my constituency, from the World Bank, from the Asian Development Bank. I went everywhere I could. I got money, I modernized all government buildings, I got roads, I got drinking water, I got everything. And what do you think? People in the constituency kept saying, "Are sakkar ke le aam ka kaale mel le?" What did we get? Because they didn't get the contracts. Everybody wants contracts so they can get a cut. Well, I was not in the game. And they were upset they didn't get contracts because they were going by tenders to whoever was doing it, because these were international agencies. Anyway, I did the best I could for 5 years. But one achievement about which I want to speak here, for 25 years, I had fought for recognizing the Siddhi community as scheduled tribes. They were of African origin. Research is still going on to see how they landed in the Western Ghats. They had nothing. They were like bonded labor working in the Arakanut gardens. And for 25 years, I fought for them. One department to the other. I had presented the petition to Parliament in 1978. And ultimately in 2004, there was the presidential order declaring the Siddhis of North Canara as scheduled tribes. It was the Siddhis of North Canara, because I had been fighting in my constituency for them. There are Siddhis in Gujarat, there are Siddhis in Maharashtra, there are in Goa, there are in Dharwad, there are in so many other districts of Karnataka, but it was only the Siddhis of North Canara that were mentioned in the presidential order because of my battle for them for 25 years. And I can tell you, without exaggeration, it has changed their lives. They are appearing for competitive exams. They are getting scholarships. They are in the railways. I opened a special center for sports development for them because they are so good in sports. A special training center for Siddhis at Bangalore, then took them on to the SAI when I was sports minister. And they have turned out to be outstanding athletes and outstanding sportspersons. Now, these are things we do in the backward areas of the state. And yesterday I was shocked when she said, you know, people say, well, she's become famous, but what has she done for her constituency?
Yes.
So maybe I should write my next book.
Okay. I think that was a question I wanted to ask you, because this is one of the criticisms.
On what one can do in the constituency and one should do. That beach, known as the Tagore Beach, was developed by me. I brought money from Delhi. An old ship of the Navy was stationed there for people to come to the beach. Everything possible was done. But when the elections came, they defeated me.
Yeah.
And I can tell you very frankly, when you are a political person, becoming a social reformer, or trying to change the status quo, you are playing with fire. Because the vested interests and those who are entrenched do not want change. They want someone whom they can manage. And that's where maybe I went wrong. With 33% reservations for women, you'll come to that, I think.
Yes.
In my constituency, women's reservation in the local bodies went up to 52%.
I think that requires a resounding applause, because that is something that has been a great achievement when it comes to women empowerment.
Because they were supposed to get 33, but they would come to me and say, Amma, nan geltene. It's become a general seat. I will win against a man. Give me a chance. So I said, go ahead, fight from the party. I was giving tickets to such women, and they were defeating the men and winning. And instead of 33%, their numbers went to 52% in my district, which upset the political bigwigs in the district very much. And they said, ee hengasu illi idre namage yenu ulidillappa ivarige onsala kaliskodi. And that is why they all got together and defeated me in 2009.
Yeah.
And well, the next thing, Sonia Gandhi sent me as a governor. But those are the ups and downs you face. You don't do anything, they say kuch kiya nahi. You do something, why should she be doing this? So you see, that's politics.
That's practical politics, probably. And therefore, I also would like you to speak about your, fight in the for the women in Indian Airlines, when the women did not have equality or equal status as such.
Well, this is a long, you must have heard, I'm sure, you are too young today. This was in the 70s, 80s. The Air India was then the national carrier, Air India and Indian Airlines. And we had these lovely women working. And they had service rules which were so discriminatory and sex-based. It is unbelievable that a national carrier with a constitution like ours could have had those rules. And they were going from door to door begging for a change. And everybody would make fun of them, and they came to me. I said, listen, stop begging. You have your rights. Why don't you go to the court and fight? I said, madam, who's going to listen to us? So my husband and I took the challenge. And we took up their case. We were both practicing. We fought in the Supreme Court. You won't believe it. They could not marry. If they married, they could not have children. And even if they did not marry and did not have children, they had to retire at 35, while the men went on to 55. So I said in Parliament, they said that women are not attractive after 35. What are we there meant to be models to keep? No, the flyers want attractive women. I said, what about the men? They are there, false teeth, paunches, bald heads. But they continue to fly. And you say, if I'm past 35, I'm not attractive enough to serve in the cabin? And one day I just want to recall this. The Minister for Civil Aviation was an old man, Sharma, from Bihar. So the question had come up in Parliament about the air hostesses. He says, nahi, nahi, ye to hum badal nahi sakte hain. The same thing. 35 ke baad mahilaen to, they can't serve in the cabin, they are not able to fly and blah blah blah. I said, saab, ek sawal pooch rahi hun. They have to serve tea and coffee and attend to the customers, which they do at home. I said, incidentally, how old is your wife at home? So he looked at me. I said, Acha, at least let me tell you, your wife is more than 50. Is she serving you tea and coffee and your food every day at home? Do you feel her services have gone down because she has become old? Do you think she's inefficient and useless because she is now past a particular age? He says, ye kya pooch rahi ho? Mujhe to takleef mat banao in my house. Don't create problems in my family. Main to uttar nahi de sakta hun. So we fought, and I must tell you, we won the case. The judgment, which is a reported judgment, came down so heavily on the government of India and said that the top management of Indian Airlines, Air India, needed psychiatric treatment. That is what the court said. So you see, you fight battles. You have many times a lot of things to fight about. I was Minister for Women for 5 years, moved so many amendments, you have mentioned.
Correct,
them.
Yes, yes.
Amendments to laws, try to move them. I remember the day I was moving the amendment. You have the Suppression of Immoral Traffic Act. So it read Sita. Suppression of Immoral Traffic Act. Short form is Sita. So they said, "Arey, Sita ka naam diya hai ye act ko. It was there before." So we said, "No, we will change it all." So we said, "Prevention of Immoral Traffic Act." They said, "Pita, arey, pita kaise bolega?" So I said, "Okay, we'll change that." So we finally found something suitable and all, and I stood to move the amendments to the act. And after question hour, the men just stood up and said, suppression of immoral traffic, huh? Just imagine. अरे अरे आज तो महिलाओं का दिन है वो बात करेंगे हम तो जाएंगे. I stood up, I said, शर्म नहीं आती है बैठ जाओ. There would be no need for an immoral traffic prevention act if it wasn't for you men. You are the culprits. And you have the cheek to say this is a women's issue. If you don't have the guts to speak, at least sit and listen. We will speak. But you will not leave the house. They just sat down.
Yes. Madam, could you also tell us about your contribution to bringing women rights, especially when it comes to your membership to Dowry Prohibition Amendment Act?
No, you see, these acts were there.
Okay.
They were passed much earlier. But there was no prosecution under the Dowry Act. Hardly any. Because they were laws drafted by men for the protection of men. And none of these laws were, I mean, you couldn't catch anybody. So we brought in amendments by which a lot of things changed and prosecution and registration of FIRs began to go up. Because the laws were changed to help the women. For instance, any death of a newly married woman within 7 years of marriage in the house of her in-laws under any kind of mysterious circumstances had to be registered as a murder, as a dowry death. And the husband and the in-laws were to be arrested immediately until they were proved innocent. You see, this brought in such a fierce psychosis among the in-laws that they began to think ki jail jayenge. There were whole families in jail after the law was changed. Till then, there was no proof because everything happens behind closed doors in the in-laws house. And there are no witnesses, there is no way to prove anything. So a lot of things like that we began to change. I mean, after the amendments began to change. And now the men are saying the law is so stringent, we need to amend it for the protection of men.
Yes.
Yes,
they say that it has been manipulated. Yes.
Law for the protection of men. In fact, I fought so many of these battles that I must say, one day Rajiv Gandhi, who was my prime minister, said to me, Margaret, you have a terrible reputation. So I looked at him, I said, what have I done? He says, you know, men are beginning to get afraid of you. They think you are anti-male. I said, sir, it's a very good reputation to have in politics for a woman. And I'm proud of it. But then I smiled at him and said, but I can tell you I'm very fond of some men. He blushed and he never raised the question again.
Yes. Despite all your, yes. Despite
so
all
you can fight yes. men, you can charm yes. them and ask them please to keep quiet.
Yes, I think that brings me to actually ask you a question as to one of your statement in the book that you have written, where you says that where you say that you were a driver, a cook, a cleaner, a teacher, an MP, an hostess, rolled into one with little time for yourself.
But that's so true of most working women. Whether you are a professor, or whether you are a doctor, or whether you are an IAS officer. These are roles which we women are compelled to combine. We do it all and we do it with a smile, though sometimes, of course, we quarrel with our husbands. But most often, women do it all. I remember even as a minister, I went to every PTA. And I tell you, I used to have a sleepless night the previous night, not knowing what was going to come. My boys were not first, last, first. And then very often I tell you, as a mother, as a minister, I used to cheat on their homework, copy their handwriting and do it in the night sometimes to prevent them from being punished. I used to draw their maps in the night because they wouldn't finish the work when I came home and I couldn't send them the next day. They would say, oh, mantri ke bete aise aate hain. So I used to cheat. I had learned to copy all their handwriting and very often I used to complete the homework in the night.
Okay.
But these are things we do. Every sports event, they wanted us there. And you had to stop everything and be there for sports day, for PTA, for things, which my husband used to go with me every time. Either he couldn't go or I couldn't go, then we went for each other. But I tell you, to be in politics and be a successful woman, you need a patient, an understanding, and a supportive husband. Otherwise, you are doomed. And I had a husband who had grown in the freedom movement. His parents were both in and out of jail. He knew what it was, what the struggle was. He encouraged me, he pushed me, he stood by me and gave me all the support and encouragement. And that's why I was able to reach where I reached. That okay. makes all the difference.
Probably I have a little few more moments, and therefore I just would like you to, you know, probably talk to our audience today as to how you would look into your role as a mother, as a member of an NGO, as a founder of an NGO. You know, how did you bring in the questions of women issues there? For example, I remember reading when it comes to Nepal, you actually looked into that UNDP program and you met a girl, very young girl who was, yes. How do you actually look at it? What you could have done better in this situations?
You know, it's difficult to say. I can tell you there is no one answer to these problems. Take, for instance, rape. I have written about it. I was in Nepal on a team of women and I saw 11-year-old girl pregnant 6 months, unable to even move. She had been rescued from some brothel in Calcutta, a Nepali girl. I mean, you see instances like this and you say, what is life all about? I worked with the hearing impaired. They have so much talent. When God denies something, he compensates. They were such good artists. I used to have mime shows put up by them. They went to Japan with their art and with their batik works. You know, they had so much talent. I ran a marriage bureau, got them married. And I used to have the receptions on my lawn as their president. I worked with the Thamana, you know, which was for children with various disabilities, I mean mental disabilities. You know, that lady was the principal of a school in Delhi. Her eldest daughter was Thamana and she had this problem.
Okay.
So she created this NGO, I joined them. And we worked with these children. We trained them to do so many things. And it was such a joy to see them picked up in buses, brought to Tamanna, trained, entertained, fed. And the parents would have a break for the day when the children were in Tamanna. So these are things which require multi-pronged approaches. There's no one answer or one solution.
Yes.
But I would say in all my work, I have found that you need to work with your heart and not so much like our modern sort of young people do with their computers and working out strategies and doing surveys and coming out. These people are not numbers. They are human beings. They can't be reduced to just creating, a chart. This is my point.
Okay. I think that also brings me to ask you a little, important role that you played in the UN, as a representative of India. Yeah. Would be, yes.
I've headed so many UN committees. One was on violence against women. One was the impact of the decade on women, in decision making. Various committees. I've been all over the world working on these issues, and I have done the best I could.
Yes.
But I've been part of many international women's movements. We were in Washington when women made the human chain between the White House and the Russian embassy during the Gorbachev and the president of the US, the summit asking for a nuclear free world. I was part of the peace movement. I've done more things than I can write about today, but I can say that I have returned home, ghar wapsi, as they say, back to Bangalore, and I'm a very satisfied person. I've given the best years of my life. I've done the best I could. And I think there's a time when you say, now the June generation should take over. You young people sit back. You don't want to be involved. You're afraid to speak out. You feel that somebody won't like it. Maybe you have to pay the price for it. Always remember, it takes courage to stand up for what you believe to be right. It requires courage to stand up and say no to what is wrong. That is character. And that's what you young, educated people are expected to be, leaders of a new India. Not just cogs in the machine, looking for a job, looking for a green card, looking to run away. No nation was ever created by its young running away from responsibility, running away from the duty to their motherland. And this is what I want you from this college, among the 25 best in the country. A star status. You have to be leaders. You have to go like lights that have been lit. You are the India of tomorrow. Don't let it be destroyed because you are afraid to speak.
That was Madam Alva. And I'm sure this book, Courage and Commitment, will bring you more such examples, experiences, as she recounts her each and every experience as a woman leader.
You should have a copy in your library.
We have, and I read it, collecting the book from the library. Librarian George gave me that copy when I asked about this. And I'm sure you have many questions, and therefore I thought I will stop here. Probably I wanted to ask one question that madam can actually sum it up later.
Okay.
And that is to ask you, how do you think the present colleges, universities should help in producing women leaders?
Why only women? There are so many
also,
boys.
And
here.
Also, yes, I was about to add up to that. But today's program basically to see that through the difficulties that probably a woman leader finds in polity.
That's right. It's more difficult for women, no doubt. There's someone who'll turn up the nose and say, hey, ye mahilayein sab aisi hain. You know, don't depend on them. Three women can't work together, they'll start quarreling. As if the men don't quarrel, look at the Karnataka government and you know how much we can quarrel. And that is why I've always said there are no men's and women's issues. There are only social issues. the mindset and the capacity to think of change. It is so easy if our forefathers had not imagined change, we would still be in the bullock cart. You are reaching for the moon. Though the mission has failed, that's another question. But you have to think of change, of rejecting what is not sustainable, what is not fair, what is not just, what is not right. We are talking about women. What wages do we pay the women who work for you in your homes, who have to maintain their families? What about child exploitation in our homes when they should be in schools? Think about the small things that you can change, and you will realize how soon society will change, how soon things will begin to take on a new meaning. I think you need to think. You need to change. You need to be leaders, not just followers. Thank you.